ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयं उदीरये Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 5, Narada's teachings to Vasudev, Text 11. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Nitya hijantor nahi tatra chodana. Nitya hijantor nahi tatra chodana. Vyavastitiste shuivaha yagya. Vyavastitiste shuivaha yagya. Sura. Graher asu nivrittirishta. Sura graher asu nivrittirishta. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Nityahi jantor nahi tatra chodana. Vyavastisisteshu vivaha yagya. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Nityahi jantor nahi tatra chodana. Vyavastitisteshu vivaha yagya. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Nyahyanto nahi tatra chodana. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Tyahi jantor nahi tatra chodana. Yavastitisteshu vivaha yagya. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Matajis. Loke vyavayamisha madhya seva. Nityahi jantor nahi tatra chodana. Vyavastitisteshu vivaha yagya. Suragrahair asu nivrittirishta. Loke vyavaya misha madhya seva. Nitya hi janto nahi chatra chodana. Vastitishtesh vivaha yagya. Nahi rasu nivittirishta. Loke vyavaya misha madhya seva. Nitya hi janto nahi tatra chodana. Vastitishtesh vivaha yagya. Suragrahai rasu nivittirishta. Loke in the material world. Vyavaya, sex indulgence. Amisha of meat. Madhya and liquor. Sevaha, the taking. Nityaha, always found. He indeed. Janto, in the conditioned living being. Na, not. He indeed. Tatra, in regard to them. Chodana, any command of scripture. Vyavastiti, the prescribed arrangement. Teshu, in these. Vivaha, by sacred marriage. Yagya, the offering of sacrifice. Suragrahe, and the acceptance of the ritual cups of wine. Ashu, of this. Nivritti, cessation. Ishta, is the desired end. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta, Swami Prabhupada's disciples. Translation. In this material world, the conditioned soul is always inclined to sex, meat-eating and intoxication. Therefore, religious scriptures never actually encourage such activities. Although the scriptural injunctions provide for sex through sacred marriage, for meat-eating through sacrificial offerings, and for intoxication to the acceptance of the ritual cups of wine, such ceremonies are meant for the ultimate purpose of renunciation. Purport. Those who are not situated in pure Krishna consciousness are always inclined towards material sense gratification in the form of illicit sex, meat-eating and intoxication. They simply desire a party life of eat, drink and be merry. Such materialistic persons are unwilling to give up such temporary gratification because they are firmly bound up in the bodily concept of life. For such persons, there are numerous Vedic injunctions for rituals that bestow material sense pleasure in a regulated manner. The conditioned soul thereby becomes accustomed to indirectly worshipping the Supreme Lord by accepting the austerity of regulated sense gratification in obedience to the Vedic way of life. Through purification, the living entity gradually develops a higher taste and becomes directly attracted to the spiritual nature of the Lord. Sometimes, the fallen practitioners of the Karmakanda section of the Vedas assert that the material fruitive results of Vedic ceremonies should never be given up because they are prescribed by religious scriptures. For example, there is a Vedic injunction that in the proper sense, a husband must approach his wife at night at least 5 days after her menstrual period if the wife has properly bathed and cleansed herself. Thus, a responsible householder should engage in religious sex life. The injunction that one must approach his wife for sex life is explained by the Vaishnava Acharyas as follows. Within the material world, almost every man is very lusty and desires passionate sex life with every attractive woman he meets, or with any woman at all. Actually, for an ordinary materialistic man, it is an accomplishment if he can restrict himself to relationships with his lawfully wedded wife. But because familiarity breeds contempt, the natural tendency is for the husband to gradually become envious or resentful of the wife and desire illicit connections with other women. Such a mentality is the most sinful and abominable, and Vedic scripture therefore orders that one must approach his actual wife with a desire to beget children and thus curtail the tendency towards illicit sexual connection with other women. Were there no such Vedic injunction ordering one to approach his wife, many men would naturally be inclined to neglect their wives and pollute other women by illicit connection. This part of the purport what we are supposed to discuss today, and later part will be discussed by next speaker. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Gadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhubhyayavacha Patidanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, welcome all the devotees for the Sunday Bhagavatam class. Hey, you might be seeing a new face. I am also new to this on giving Bhagavatam class on Sunday. So request all the assembled Vaishnavas, especially all the senior devotees that have been coming here for the last 10, 15, 20, 25 years to attend Srimad Bhagavatam class almost every Sunday. And it was on a short notice, and I could just collect whatever I could collect, just like Chowpatty Beach has a lot of this Bhelpuri Wallas. They just take different things and just mix and give you. So some Bhel I'll serve, although this is supposed to be a main meal, but today you'll have to just be satisfied with some fast food. So this chapter, the 11th canto, chapter 5, the whole Srimad Bhagavatam is compared to is the literary incarnation of the Supreme Lord. And the first two cantos are the Lord's first two lotus feet, the lotus feet. And then as gradually progressing, the 10th canto is the face of the Lord. The beautiful face of the Lord. Therefore, one of the meanings of Srimad Bhagavatam is that the beautiful Lord. Shri means beauty. And that Lord or that book that brings out the beauty of the Supreme Lord is Srimad Bhagavatam. Bhagavad Gita brings out the greatness of the Lord. And Srimad Bhagavatam brings out the beauty of the pastimes and the form of the Lord. And 11th canto is said to be the forehead of the Lord. And the 12th canto is compared to the hair of the Lord, the beautiful blackish curly hair of the Lord. And usually, you know, the forehead is something where we store all of our information. All students are trying to grab as much as they can into this brain. They say that if the syllabus is of 80 GB of data, the students can only take 80 MB. Out of the 80 GB, only 80 MB goes into the head. And when it comes to bring out into the onto the exam paper, only 80 KB comes out. So at least if you can take whatever knowledge and then apply, even if 80 KB is there, then it is of use. So this head, we are all struggling to in spiritual life, in the academic life, to take as much information as possible. Therefore, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in this literary incarnation, all the knowledge that the 10 cantos discussed is put together once in the 11th canto. Anybody that read 11th canto here can know that it is quite exhaustive. It appears to be till 10 cantos I reached, that was one struggle. But to complete this 11th canto is another big struggle. And some of our devotees take these seminars on Uddhav Gita and different things. It is very exhaustive. Because it is compared to the forehead of the Lord. And forehead of the Supreme Lord, Supreme Godhead, must be also very exhaustive. And then the 12th canto is the the description of the Kali, how Kali Purush, the Kalki will come, and the final conclusions, what is of the most important essence. Srimad Bhagavatam is also compared to the rising of the sun. Just like when it is explained in the first canto, that when the Supreme Lord went away, Krishne Swadamo Pagate Dharma Jnana Dibi Saha, when the Supreme Lord 5000 years back, when he went back to the spiritual world, he took along with him dharma and jnana. Everything went with him. But just to show us vision, kalau nashtra drishamesha puranarko uditaha. Just to give us the vision in the absence of the Supreme Lord, this Srimad Bhagavatam has risen. And just like sun goes through 12 months, the Srimad Bhagavatam has 12 cantos. And we are currently in the month of November, and that is also 11, and this canto is also 11. And although December is supposed to be again 31 days, but in the Srimad Bhagavatam it is only very small canto. 12th canto just finishes like this. Maybe because devotees are all busy in the marathon in the month of December, some of the Bhagavatam also, the 12th canto is quite short. So this is a very important canto for us to understand, because unless we understand, we won't be able to apply this knowledge that we are receiving from the Lord. And in the beginning of this chapter, the Chamasa Muni was asked by King Nimi, This is a conversation between one king and nine sages that come to his assembly, and is inquiring from each one of them very relevant, pertinent questions. And therefore, and also it is said, the quality of one's life is dependent on the quality of questions he asks in life. If somebody is just asking, where can I get food, then that will be his quality of life. But if somebody is asking, why am I searching for food? Why I have to be dissatisfied every 3 hours, 4 hours, again pursue? And for some of us, as we are taking one meal, we are thinking about the next meal. What will be in the next meal? Therefore, one of the sannyasis, Iskcon, says that sometimes devotee's life goes from one plate of prasadam to the next plate of prasadam. You're just worried about when will be the meal. And if there is no higher inquiry or there is no higher absorption even in that meal, then the quality of life won't be as good. And here King Nimi, series of very amazing questions. The question with which this chapter starts is that, my dear Yogendras, all of you are most perfect in knowledge of the science of the self. Therefore, kindly explain to me the destination of those who for the most part never worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, who are unable to quench their material desires and who are not in control of their own selves. So somebody who doesn't worship the Lord and is just running after sense gratification, trying to gratify his senses, trying to indulge into senses, what is the destination of that person? And this particular verse talks about, in fact, when we give our seminar on four regulative principles, this is one of the verses that we discuss. And here, the purport, the translation is that, why is there regulations in the Vedas, especially on these four things: meat eating, intoxication, illicit sex, and gambling? And anybody that comes into the Iskcon society, in the first journey of self-discovery, the last session, we are told that if you want to seriously practice spiritual life, then these are the four do nots. These are the four things that you need to avoid. And many a times this becomes one of the biggest obstacles, that how can I give up this or that, especially giving up tea. Giving up tea becomes a very difficult affair, because in India, tea is the exchange of love. Wherever you go, they offer you tea. Therefore, they say, as soon as somebody comes to the house, it is hi. Then they give him chai. And then they say him bye. So this, in this Indian culture of hi, chai, bye, to give up tea becomes very difficult. And what to speak of other things. And now with Jio and all these mobile networks, and our access to all, breaking all these regulative principles has become so easy. And if someone is too interested to indulge into them, the Vedas don't just deny. Because the Lord, being all compassionate, he wants somehow or other to be connected to him, either directly or indirectly. And also in this verse, it is said that sometimes we get accustomed to just being indirectly worshipping the Lord by following all the rules and regulations of the scriptures, the Karmakanda section, and think that I am fine with this kind of lifestyle. And this, the occasion in which we are discussing the Bhagavatam, is the month of Kartik, a very holy, auspicious month, the month of Srimati Radharani, and all devotees, they take lot of hardship to try to come to the temple or any program where Damodar Ashtakam is being offered. And it's a joyous occasion, because it's like a family get together. whole year may we not see each other much, but especially because of the yatra, because of the Kartik month, we keep bumping into each other so many times, at programs, at the temple, and the atmosphere somehow is very divine. The combination of all the lights switched on and just the lights on the Lord, the singing of the Damodar Ashtakam with nice melody, and the offering of these lamps, ghee lamps. The combination of these three just somehow creates such positive spiritual energy that we get addicted to this. We want to keep coming, and even after Kartik, sometimes devotees ask, why can't we have this every day? Let's continue to have this every day instead of just 1 month. And we all feel that great spiritual energy during the Damodar month. And although it's not that stealing Krishna did only once. He stole many times. In Gokul, it is an everyday affair. And initially they were all wondering, where is all the makan going? Where is all the butter that we are churning going in? And it's not the first time that Lord Krishna was caught. He was caught many times. Sometimes the gopi catches Krishna and Krishna gives some excuse, like one time when Krishna was stealing the butter, his hands were in the butter, and then the gopis caught Krishna. And then they asked Krishna, why are you stealing butter? We have caught you red-handed. We are going to take a photograph. And Krishna said that my mother has put these bangles of gems and they are burning. And because they are burning, I put my hands into butter just to cool off. But then gopis asked the next question for which Krishna didn't add an answer. Then the gopis asked, what is the butter doing on your mouth? Ye muh mein kya kar raha hai? And the Krishna just became shy, embarrassed. So it's not the first time that Krishna stole. It was not the first time or the only time when Krishna was caught. Another time, which is a very famous pastime, where the gopi actually takes Krishna with his catching him to Mother Yashoda. And Krishna starts to tell, warn her, don't take me to my mother. And the gopi doesn't listen because she wants to relish discussing about Krishna stealing. But then the whole story is very beautiful. Then she sees that it is actually when she complained and she was pointing to Krishna, Krishna turned into his own son, her own son. And she was so embarrassed that I caught my own son and brought to Mother Yashoda to complain. You don't complain about your children in the neighbor's house. You complain in your own house. And then this was very embarrassing. And she could not figure out, was I in some dilemma, some delirium? What happened? And then Krishna was being taken back, when his own son was being taken back, Krishna again became Krishna. And he told, I told you not to take me, not to expose me in front of Mother Yashoda. And this time I only became your son, but next time I'll become your husband. And when I become your husband, that will be too embarrassing for you, because your husband will also chastise. Because child will not chastise, but the husband will definitely chastise if you make a joke out of him. And so many times Krishna was caught stealing butter. And in fact, the gopis always sing. But it is maybe only once that Krishna was punished for his stealing. And that is Damodar Leela. So only out of many times that Krishna was stealing, was caught, this was one time when Mother Yashoda could successfully punish her son, Nanda Kishore, Yashoda Nandan, to a wooden grinding mortar. And this, as I was in this dilemma of what should I discuss, first of all, it was on short notice, just yesterday evening. And over that, the purport is quite heavy about illicit sex and intoxication and this whole concept of wanting to enjoy but restrictions. And the month of Kartik, because most devotees come once a week to the temple and they would like to hear something about this Leela. And someone rescued me. And those that rescued me are in the pastime. They are Nalakuvera and Manigriva. Because in this whole Leela, Mother Yashoda is a pure devotee. Nanda Maharaj, they are all exalted souls. Krishna is directly the Supreme Lord. Whom can we relate to? We can relate to Nalakuvera and Manigriva. And it also connects to this verse. Because these two were an example of someone who was just indulged into sense gratification. And the indulgence was so much that they neglected to respect Narada Muni. And usually when we take initiation, these four regulative principles are emphasized. The devotees take vows. And sometimes it is funny the way vows are taken, but the vows are pretty serious. And the vows that are taken, usually we call them, I'll follow these four regulative principles. Although we call them principles, the vows that are taken are usually the activities. And by just following the activities, four regulative activities, we start to think that we are following the four regulative principles. But each one of these activities that we emphasize not to get into has a principle that we need to develop in our life, has a spiritual principle that we need to develop. And these four principles actually form the basis for dharma to stand. They form the four pillars. And these four pillars are usually also mentioned in the classes where the four regular principles are taken, that the principle of meat eating, that why one should not indulge into killing animals, hurting animals, is the principle of compassion, right? Because the principle of compassion, because the philosophy, all the philosophy in those scriptures should boil down to some principles. They boil down to some principles. And once the principles are there, the principles can't just be in the air. The principles should come into practicals. So unless the philosophy comes into some principles of life that you want to apply, and unless the principles come into practicals, then it is no use. Else it is said, an ounce of practice is much better than a ton of theory. So many principles are there in the scriptures, but we just neglect them or we are not able to follow them. But somehow or other to try to follow in our life. So the principle has to be started to apply, develop in our life, the principle of compassion. And no gambling is the principle of truthfulness, not getting into any of these affairs of lottery and other things. And the principle of the regulative principle of no intoxication, it's usually austerity. And the principle of no illicit sex is basically cleanliness. And a few months back when I had to give this seminar, I was thinking that there must be more into this, more something more practical than seeing compassion, truthfulness, austerity and cleanliness. Maybe a step deeper than this. And the principle of compassion, which the scriptures say that all spiritual aspirants should develop. On day-to-day level, we all, most of us follow the principle of no meat eating. But on day-to-day level, on the most practical scenario, the compassion boils down to the principle of sensitivity. Being sensitive to others' suffering. being sensitive to others' life. And unless we develop this quality, principle of sensitivity, this quality, then just following, no meat eating, is not actually going to help us, because so many in India follow this no meat eating, being vegetarian. But the principle that is being emphasized, that are you sensitive to others? And Maharaj many times says that in other religions, they are very cruel to the animals. They just kill animals, all types of animals. But they are very kind to the humans, to each other. And somehow, in Indian setup or in the Vedic setup, sometimes we are very kind to the animals. We should not kill the animals. We won't take any kind of meat. But we are very cruel to the humans, very cruel to the devotees in terms of the way we speak. Most of the speech that we do is usually to put down someone, to discourage someone. Sometimes I go for these birthday celebrations where there is kirtan also. And I ask people, okay, we are celebrating his birthday, but I want each one of you to speak one good thing about him. And they all become dumb, because they are not able to think of something good about this person. They can only think about something good about the person once the person's face is replaced by his photo. In front of the photo, in the memorial, everybody speaks good about him. But when the photo was alive, nobody is there around him that is actually encouraging him, that is actually sensitive to his feelings, sensitive to the kind of life he is going through. And usually that is one of the reasons why after some years, some months of coming, somebody because of some reason stops coming to the temple. And then it becomes a big obstacle to him for to come back again, because he is thinking, what will devotees see? Because devotees will just say, "Phir se Maya mein gir gaya." You have again gone back to Maya, or they'll just catch him and try to thrash him with all the philosophy. And of course he's struggling, he needs that dose also, but he also needs some empathy. And when that empathy is not there, when that sensitivity is not there, then it becomes very difficult for someone to grow or be accepted in the spiritual community. There is this story that is told about the Queen of England. The Queen of England, she had invited one of the tribal kings of Africa to London. And when he came, when the king came, this tribal king came, obviously he came with his tribal attire. If you see, even in United Nations, there are some countries from which they are represented, and they come in that wild attire of all these feathers everywhere, all types of markings. They sit in United Nations because they just want to represent their tradition. So the tribal king came from Africa, and he sat in this huge dining table where all the ministers and the queen was sitting. And they served the meal. And the meal was being taken. Of course, then only was bewildered how to eat, because with this knife and a fork, the way to eat, the Britishers are pretty strict on how they eat, the way they eat. And he was struggling to eat, but somehow he completed the meal. And after the meal is complete, usually what is done in these royal circles is that to wash hands, they get finger bowls. They get lemon finger bowls where you have hot water with lemon inside, and you just wash your hands with this lemon water. So the finger bowl also came there in front of him. And this African king, he didn't know that it's supposed to be for washing hands. Because whatever came in front of him, he thought, I just have to take it. So he took the finger bowl and he drank it. And all the ministers, they were all looking. Ye kya kar raha hai? Because it was not tradition. Like say, in the temple, if somebody comes into the temple hall with shoes on, then obviously everybody will look at him like, you don't know the tradition here that you are supposed to leave your chappal and your ego at the shoe stall. Because if you carry these both, you will have trouble. So everybody was looking amused at him. Ki kaun sa gaon se aaya hai? What kind of place he is coming from that he doesn't even know that he is supposed to wash his hands. But the queen, the whole purpose she brought the king was to make relationship, make a friendship. And this one incident would have destroyed, because it is supposed to be for washing, and as soon as the finger bowl came, everybody just put their hands and they were washing. And when the king gets embarrassed, though, I was supposed to wash my hands, but here I'm drinking. The queen took the finger bowl and she also started to drink. Which never before it's been done, but she was sensitive. She didn't want to hurt the king of Africa because he doesn't know the tradition. And as the queen was drinking, the ministers, very reluctantly, they all had to lift their finger bowl and also had to drink their own hand wash. And this story is told many times of the principle of sensitivity. Not to hurt others, to offer respect to others. That's the principle of which Lord Chaitanya describes. Amanina manadena. That to offer respect, being sensitive to other Vaishnavas, other people. And unless we follow this, just at the superficial level of, oh, I'm not eating meat, therefore I'm following this principle of compassion, is superficial. And same way the principle of gambling, of not of being untruthful. Now truth has so many levels. There is something called as tatya. Tatya is that which is happening. But satya is not just tatya. There is tatya and there is mitya. Mitya means cooked up. Something that is just mythological, not true, but somebody just cooks up. But mitya and tatya, but there is a higher level of satya. Satya means to be aware of the reality in such a way that we actually progress towards eternity. Sat. That is satya. And therefore, when you want to tell something someone, if you just tell him bare facts without giving him the proper context by which that information will help him to progress towards Krishna, it is not actually being truthful. It is just being factful. And this principle, on a practical level, it comes down to the quality of being honest. That honesty is a very essential principle for growth, for advancing in spiritual life. And Dhruva, in the fourth canto, when Narada Muni approached him in the forest, and he saw Dhruva's determination to want to go and see the Supreme Lord, get benediction from the Supreme Lord within short time. When he saw his determination, he wanted to test him, that whether he is honest. And he gives him two tests, Narada Muni. And these two tests will be faced by each one of us. Either the world will put upon us, or our own mind, or our spiritual mentors, counselors may also pose. One is called as fear of success test, the fear test. And this is what Narada Muni also posed to Dhruva. He told Dhruva that, you know how difficult it is to achieve the Supreme Lord? great sages, Pantastu Koti Satavatsara Sampragamyo, that many munis, many sages, since thousands of years, they have been searching for the Supreme Lord. And still they are not able to achieve Him. And big, big sages, devotees have not been able to achieve and see the Supreme Lord. And here you are, just 5 years of age. What chance do you have to achieve it? Say if there is a bowler who is really hard to play, because the way he swings the ball, nobody can guess. And every best player in the world, number one, have been bowled in the first ball when he bowls. Virat Kohli or Sachin Tendulkar or whoever it is, they're all just getting bowled in the first ball. And then here you have been just playing gully cricket. And because you are something good in your gully cricket, you think you are going to face this fast bowler whom nobody before has been able to defend. That will be foolishness. And that's what Narad Muni told. So many people have left the movement. So many people have not able to practice these principles, being austere on all these principles. Therefore, what chance do you have, Dhruva, to able to achieve the Supreme Lord? And Rupa Goswami, when he writes in Padyavali, one of the verses, he says different disqualifications that each devotee had, but how, because Krishna is very merciful, they overcame their disqualification. And in regards to Dhruva, the disqualification that Dhruva had was he lacked any kind of maturity. 5 saal ke bachche ko kya pata hai jeevan ke bare mein, and what to speak of God. And therefore, because he lacked any kind of maturity, how can he achieve the Supreme Lord? And so Dhruva was feared that Javamat, don't take up 16 rounds, because so many devotees do night chanting, NCC club, night chanters club. Itne bade bade logon ke saath nahi ho raha hai. Tumhare saath kya hoga? You don't have any time. The mind may propose this. The second test that all of us will be faced is what Narad Muni told Dhruva, is called as complacency test. That you don't have to give up your family, your comfort zone, and go to the forest to achieve Krishna. Just staying at home, so many kings in the past, many householders have achieved Krishna. To kuch hatke karne ka zarurat nahi hai. Just get married, have children, worship Krishna to your best of ability, expand your kingdom, enjoy life, and as you are enjoying life, Krishna will also be achieved. And that's one of the prominent philosophies in India, that sab chhodke only Krishna, and doing this, not being at home in Diwali. This is all considered to be very radical. That just be normal. If you are just normal, Krishna is happy with you. Don't be abnormal like all these Hare Krishnas. And that is also said, that complacency test, that you don't have to do all these things to achieve God. You'll achieve, just live life normally. And Dhruva was posed these both tests by Narad Muni. That just go back, and if you want to go ahead, it's really difficult. And most of us, if Narad Muni tells that, tumse nahi hoga. Like say our spiritual master comes and says, tumko Krishna kabhi milne wale nahi hai. So what will happen? We'll get discouraged. And we'll say, okay, Guru Maharaj, I'll go back. I'll do my life. But here, Dhruva was honest in his pursuit and honest in his ability. And he said that, see, I can't be just take these curses, and because I am a Kshatriya, I have to do something. In regards to achieving Krishna, it is difficult. If so many have tried, and even if I fail, what is the loss? Tyaktva tadharmam charanam bhujam harer. Even if I fail, my family, my kingdom, living a normal life, it may get hampered in this life, but next life I'll start from zero. So many a times we think that my life will get affected, but we have been given hundreds of lives. And Prabhupada and scriptures are saying, just give one life to Krishna. We don't have to give. And if you just give one life to Krishna, then you'll see what results it will carry. So because of this quality of honesty, Dhruva made rapid spiritual progress. Most of the times when we approach our spiritual counselors, spiritual masters, we are not honest in our pursuit. We are not honestly actually looking for Krishna. We are looking for some good things that we get from Krishna. Therefore, Ravindra Swarup Prabhu says, most people want the results of spiritual life, want the results of purity, without willing to go through the process of purification. We don't want to take the hard struggle, and therefore most of us are not honest in our pursuit to want to have Krishna. Therefore, that is said, there are two types of devotees. One are believers, and believers there are many in India. We just believe Krishna. But others, those who are sadhakas, are seekers. That we are actively seeking Krishna. It's not that Krishna is there and we are just happy with that. No, we are actively trying to pursue Krishna in our life. And unless we seek Krishna, most of the times what happens? Once we come to Iskcon, we complete JSD, we get initiation, we think we got Krishna. And that desire to search for Krishna stops. Desire to seek Krishna stops, we stop seeking Krishna actively. So that honesty in that pursuit goes away. We become enamored by, say, position or other things that will give us temporary respect, and that main thing is lost. And from Dhruva, we can learn this quality of being honest, and this will definitely help us. And part of that honesty is, yes, no gambling and all the practical thing that is given. And the principle of intoxication. Again, it is austerity. But intoxication, the actual principle that intoxication is trying to quality is independency. Already we are very dependent on the body, and when we take intoxication, all these drugs, we become more and more dependent on the body and body's needs. Therefore, you see, many people, as soon as they get up in the morning, they have to drink tea. If they don't get tea, they get headache, they can't pass their bowels, because they become dependent. And this dependency on matter will never allow us to become independent of the material hankerings. And therefore, the principle of fasting, not getting into toxic things, is to allow us to develop this being in, not dependent on material things. First of all, it is addictive things. Then comes, say, basic things. Say, many devotees take vows to not take sweets and whatever addicts them, whatever makes them dependent. And then there is also dependency on respect, position. These are also addictive things. And that's what happened with Nalakuvar and Manigriva. They were associates, they were the children of Kuvera, two spoiled brats, two millennials, two children that were so much having money and comfort and enjoyment. And over that, they were also very close to Shiva, Lord Shiva, because Lord Shiva and both Kuvera, they stay in the Himalayas. They are kind of neighbors and also related. And because they were very close associates of Lord Shiva, Prabhupada explains in the Krishna book that they became proud of their position, and that intoxicated them. And that intoxication with position and power also made them to get intoxicated with wine. Because they, now they can do anything because they have that connection. And usually this happens when we are around powerful people, spiritually powerful or materially powerful, because we are connected to them, we get proud. Most people that become powerful out of their own hard work, they usually are not proud. Because we can become wealthy in four ways. One is through inheritance. You are just born as a child of Ambani. And then what to do? You are inherited with wealth, with position. Second is to steal. Chori kiya. Say, most of the world was colonized and that colonization was just to steal. So, that is one way, just to steal wealth. Third is to win wealth. Say you win some lottery, at go for KBC, Kaun Banega Karodpati, and then you win the lottery. And fourth is to earn it. And though most people that earn power, earn wealth, not just inherit, they usually are not proud because they know what it takes and they are grounded. But usually when we inherit either spiritual blessings or the association, we not see in the hard times or the difficult phases that go through a community, then we take for granted, we think, I am great because the movement or the temple or the devotee that I am connected to is great, therefore I am great. Prabhupada always used to say, I am great, my country is great because I am great. Or now that my country has been said as Mahan, therefore because I am an Indian, I am also Mahan. But Nalakuvara Manigriva, their association with Lord Shiva, because it was in a wrong context to become materially seen as powerful, that didn't purify them. But the second association with Narada Muni, which humbled them, didn't give them any power position, but stripped them off of all their power and position, actually gave them purification in Krishna. So both are great souls, Lord Shiva and Narada Muni. But association with one gave them entanglement. And association with other gave them liberation. But the fault is not with the either Shiva or with Narada Muni. The fault is in how you approach. How you approach these great souls. One was, of course, both was with contempt. But Narada Muni actually taught them a lesson. And then when Narada Muni saw that they were just totally arrogant, not being even covering their clothes, that time, seeing that the wealth has caused them this pride, and the beautiful chapter in the Srimad Bhagavatam where he says that it is much better to be poor than to be rich if someone is powerful, becomes arrogant because of his riches. And he says usually a poor person easily approaches a saintly person, but if a saintly person wants to approach a rich man, it is very difficult because first of all his heart is closed and second his door is closed. Prabhupada always used to say, outside every house, big bungalow, they write, beware of dog. And it is not easy to approach. And but for a poor man, if he meets a saintly person, if he meets a sadhu, a devotee, because already he is very afflicted, he naturally is in a mood to take shelter. Therefore, Bhaktitirtha Maharaj used to say, what is preaching? He used to say, preaching means to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comforted. If somebody is already afflicted, already painful, suffering, to him, you don't have to go and speak that there are four more miseries. Four real problems in life, birth, death, disease and old age. He is thinking, already I am bogged by all this GST and so many things. And now you are speaking more problems. He gets only depressed. To him, you have to speak about the beauty of the spiritual world, because he is already ready. He is suffering, he is afflicted. You have to comfort him by telling him the good side of life. And somebody who is too cozy in his life, because either he is lazy or he is having all the things that he wants in life, then usually he is comfortable. And for somebody who is comfortable, if you tell him the glory of the spiritual world, the beauty of the spiritual world, he says, that looks like Hawaii. I go every year there. So he won't be much attracted unless you tell him the distress that is there in the material world. This thing that you are going to have is not forever. It is going to end. There was a king that was too comfortable, and there was a sadhu that came. And this sadhu told, first of all, saw his hand, and as soon as you see the hand, then you want to know. Like recently I was showing my hand to one doctor here in the temple. I had some skin thing, I was showing him. Then immediately one person came and said, "Mera bhi haath dekho." Because he thinks he's seeing my hand and wanting to tell my future. But I say, I'm showing my skin problem, not my life problem. And the king was eager. And the king was told, you're going to have a great life, but your great life is going to end very soon. So the king was morose. But he said, don't worry, there is a good news also. The good news is, because you are very charitable, you're going to go to the Swargaloka, heavenly planet. That's the good news. Then he was again comforted. And to afflict him, he said, but there is a bad news. The bad news is, because of all this religion being practiced nicely, there is a lot of crowd in heavenly planet. Swargalok mein bheed bahut bad gaya. It is too crowded. And he didn't like crowds. Then he comforted him, saying, don't worry, because you have been a king and very good person, you are going to get a palace for you, even in that crowded place. Then again he was comforted. Again he was afflicted by saying, there is a bad news. The bad news is that in your palace there are a lot of mosquitoes. You know, all places, like you take some place far off, but then there are a lot of mosquitoes that just want to suck your blood. Again he was afflicted. But said, again he comforted, there is a good news, that in your palace there is a mosquito net that is available. All devotees now going to Mayapur. We all take mosquito nets or Odomos or something, because a lot of mosquitoes sometimes in Mayapur. And again he was comforted. But again he afflicted him, saying that in that mosquito net that you are going to be given, there is a big hole in that. And he comforted him, saying, but there is thread that is available in this heavenly planet. All you need to do is take a needle with you. Wahan pe sui nahi milta hai. You don't get a needle there. You just take a needle from here. And he stopped this comforting, afflicting business. And the king realized, I can't take a needle. I can't take anything. Because when I die, I can't take anything that I have bought or I have. I just die. And that's what, and the saint said, that's what I wanted to tell you, that you can't take even a needle from this world, but you are trying to amass and being comfortable here. Don't be comfortable. Use your comforts to worship Krishna. Therefore, they say, prosperity is not a deity to worship or a demon to abhor, but an instrument to serve the Lord. And when prosperity comes, we should not get into Nalakuvera and Manigriva's kind of life and neglect to respect Vaishnavas, neglect to offer some service to the Vaishnavas. And Krishna is very happy when Vaishnavas are served, because this is something which he himself wants to do. We were just in Govardhan, and the Palindri Mataji there, she was giving a beautiful class, and she was telling us that why is Krishna so happy when we serve the Vaishnavas, because there is always a competition between devotee and Krishna, because both want to serve each other. Krishna wants to serve his devotee, and his devotees want to serve Krishna. And Krishna has so many ways in which he enjoys, and therefore devotees always get some way to serve Krishna. But devotee doesn't want anything. And because he doesn't want anything, how can Krishna serve his devotee? That is one thing. Second is, devotee doesn't want to take service from Krishna. He doesn't want to take service from Krishna, he wants to serve Krishna. That is the story of Rupa Goswami when he was writing at Tir Kadam. Radharani was coming and shading him. Then Sanatan Goswami came and said, we are trying to become the servants of Radha and Krishna, not take service from Radha and Krishna. So better you make a hut and sit inside that. And Rupa Goswami sat in the hut. He didn't was hurt. Hurt kar di bolte. He actually agreed because he wanted to serve Radha Krishna. So because of these two issues, devotee does not want anything. Devotee does not want to take any service from Krishna. So therefore, how can he serve his devotee? Therefore, if somebody else comes and offers some service to Krishna, to Vaishnava, Krishna is very happy, because something that he is not able to do, the devotee is able to, that person is able to do, of offering some service to that Vaishnava. Therefore, Krishna regards Vaishnava Seva as a high regard, because this is the way we please Krishna very much, because we get opportunity to serve the Vaishnavas. And for all the devotees that are going for Mayapur Yatra, Maharaj always says that the more devotees, more opportunity to serve. And if we are in that mood, okay, I am able to give more opportunity to serve Vaishnavas, then we will be actually grateful and grow. And in this pastime of Nalakuvar and Manigriva, when they became humble and when they appreciated Krishna's glory and the Mother Yashoda and all the Vaishnavas' glory, that time Krishna came and he made this ukhal get fixed amidst them. And then Krishna was in front and the ukhal was stuck. And Mother Yashoda had tied the ukhal to Krishna because the ukhal was helping Krishna in this stealing. So he was an accomplice. Because he helped Krishna do a crime, he was also punished. And ukhal was very happy because now he was with Krishna. And then Krishna was dragging all along. The ukhal was also very happy because in spiritual world, everything is alive. But when the ukhal got stuck amidst these trees, the ukhal went into great desperation. Because now Krishna is there and I am stuck here. And this is what happens. Initially, we are riding along with Krishna, in the Krishna consciousness movement. And at some point, we get stuck. We see everybody happy with Krishna, but we are stuck because of some anarthas that we have, and we are not able to come over. And in this pastime, Krishna was just pushing the ukhal to come. It was difficult if Krishna was just practical. Krishna would have just come behind through that, between the two trees, and come and played from some other route. But Krishna chose that I'll only purify you through your anardas. Therefore, they say, only when we go through our life, not try to escape, go through our services, we actually grow. When we try to escape our services, we don't grow. When we try to deal with our anardas in proper way, in Krishna consciousness, then we grow. If we try to be in a situation where we are not even, of course, we should not get into temptations, but say just staying in Vrindavan all life will not purify us, because we also have to be honest to our conditionings and accordingly take up some responsibility to serve Krishna. So the Ukal, Acharya has explained, Ukal was in great separation. And this separation made its eagerness to want to go and meet Krishna great. And in any rope, the rope can be moved. Of course, I wanted to get a rope, but somehow I couldn't. So the rope can only move forward when you pull it. If you try to push, the rope doesn't move ahead. It just becomes jumbled up. Same way here, Krishna was pulling and the Ukal was actually being pulled by Krishna's attraction. And because it was pulling, being pulled by Krishna's attraction, it got the strength to actually dismantle these twin Arjuna trees. So the twin Arjuna trees, we think were dismantled by Krishna. But it was that bhakti rope that gave that strength to that Ukal. Ukal is also made of wood, chota wood hai. And that is huge trees. It is that wood, because of that bhakti baddha, that bhakti rope that was connected to it to Krishna, it got the strength. So Krishna always glorifies his devotees, like Hanumanji flew and Krishna walked. So Krishna always glorifies, even in this pastime, he is giving all the glory of breaking the twin Arjuna trees to the Ukal. But Ukal only got that strength because it got great desperation to want to reach Krishna. And the lesson that Acharyas give is, we'll only be able to overcome on another's the things that we get stuck when we are greatly attracted by Krishna. And in that great attraction, in that madness, we will be able to overcome all the anardhas that are not allowing us to go towards Krishna. That's what the twin Arjuna trees represent. And it's time is up. There's some more things that I wanted to discuss, but I'll be honest to the time. And thank Paldev Prabhu and all the senior Vaishnavas for giving me this opportunity to share something about this pastime and this verse. And if there was something that added value to your life, I'll be very grateful. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki.